CQDX, CQDX, CQDX. This is Havana calling. CQDX, CQDX, CQDX. This is Radio Havana calling all shortwave listeners and radio amateurs. Welcome to... DXers Unlimited, Radio Havana's weekly feature dedicated to the fascinating world of radio communications.
Amigos de radio aficionados all around the world are listening to this, the middle of the week edition of your favorite radio hobby show, DXers Unlimited. I'm Nicolo, your host, is ready to bring you more radio hobby information covering the 93 different ways we enjoy this wonderful way of making the best possible use of the time spent playing with our radios and accessories. Here's now item one. This is a special topic. I want you, it's a very controversial one, brought up to my attention from the K0NR radio website. Is the internet destroying amateur radio? Listen again to the question. Is the internet destroying amateur radio? That Bob, amateur radio operator K0NR, continues his analysis by saying, how many times are you hearing the comment, ham radio, do people still do that? Followed by the statement that surely the internet has made ham radio completely obsolete. For the most part, that misses the point about the use and attractiveness of amateur radio. Bob says that he has written before that amateur radio is not for talking and that the universal purpose of ham radio is to have fun messing around with your radios. One significant statistic is that the number of amateur radio licensees in the United States of America remains at an all-time high. Amateur operators are approaching now the 10,000 mark at an all-time high also. It is true that eventually, because of the demographic pyramid will likely catch up with us and this number will start to recover. But that hasn't happened yet. The fact is that the internet has become a tool that is used to complement amateur radio, often in ways that we may not have predicted at all. Folks in the hobby say that there are many or more that have found that they have very clever ways to make use of the internet in the benefit of the ham radio hobby. K0NR, Bob, then asks in his writing that he views emerging technologies and technological innovation as unstoppable forces that will impact us whether we try to ignore them or not. Using that lens as the point of view, Bob takes us into the idea of examining the impact of the internet on amateur radio. And he has a few broad categories of impact. Here's number one, a communications pipe. The internet is often used to provide an additional mechanism for transporting ham-type radio communications that do not use the airwaves. Obvious examples are voice over IP systems such as Echolink and IRRP, India Romeo Lima Papa, the IRRP network. Included in this category are these voices that use the internet to connect radios together. These are, yes, signal fusion and others. Much used by long-range jets, ocean-going jets, is Winlink, a global email system that uses ham radio as its support. The core transport technology is the Internet Protocol Suite, TCP/IP, which is not limited to the public internet. Some ham radio organizations are implementing their own private IP link using microwave gear on the amateur radio band, so they are independent of the internet. Another interesting more possible enthusiast is an application in this category that makes possible remote operation of a really fully equipped amateur radio station with many antennas and many radios. That is using an internet connection to control a ham radio station at a remote location. After this, we will have private stations where there are also shared stations established by radio clubs and commercial vendors also. With now widespread community restrictions, the famous covenants and the use of external antennas being very common everywhere around the world, having the possibility of installing and using a remote station available is very attractive for many amateur radio operators. This is Radio Havana Cuba. The name of the show is DXers Unlimited, and today we are presenting a very special topic, amateur radio on the internet, that now continues. Do you use of remotely operated amateur radio stations has turned out to be quite disruptive because so much of ham radio operating depends on your location, your QTH, which is generally determined by the location, the QTH of the transmitter. But now you can have a person sitting in downtown Denver, Colorado, USA, Paris, France, or Havana, Cuba, operating a transmitter that is located maybe way out into the Pacific Ocean, island of Fiji, or at a base camp in Antarctica. Regulatory issues also come into play now. That transmitter in Fiji or in the Antarctica is going to fall under Fiji or Antarctica regulations of the country that operates the Antarctica base, which usually means needing an amateur radio license used by the local government. The day is coming when a new expedition to a remote island will probably consist of a helicopter delivering a remote radio box, which has a light link and self-deploying high-frequency antennas that is then remotely operated by someone sitting at home using a smartphone via the internet. The future, maybe. Reporting and coordination is also a very useful use of the internet that actually benefits amateur radio. Ham radio operators also use the internet for spotting and reporting purposes. Spotting has been known for a long time now. Basically means letting other amateurs know that a particular station is on the air and can be worked from a particular location. Hams have done this without the internet, but using the internet for that purpose usually allows. It certainly allows for more efficiency of the process, or at least a lot more spots. It's a good example of spotting website that supports map and mapping of spots. Radio hams also use the internet for coordinating radio contacts on special modes. One of the most extreme examples is the use of email for arranging meteoscopic communications. Finally, I do want to make reference to the very useful reverse beacon network I've been using for a long time now. And RBN, Reverse Beacon Network, is a very useful network of radio receivers spread all around the world, listening to the amateur bands and reporting what stations they pick up. These stations are often referred to as CW skimmers because they skim the most code information from the received signals. RBN, which is carrying CW, but also now supports RTDY. There's no fundamental reason it couldn't be extended to other modes, for example, PSK31 or other digital modes. And one more thing is also, the radio networks provide a very complete picture of available propagation of stations on the air. Some hams complain that nobody tunes to that around anymore, because they don't rely on the station of interest to be spotted by one of those DX spotters. Often the experience of huge pile-up, as soon as spotted, is one of the things that happen when something rare blows up the air on the map. Finally, logs and confirmations. For decades, amateurs have been keeping the logs using now a wide range of software available, mostly freeware. It's a handy way of keeping track of radio contacts and tracking progress towards operating awards. More recently, online systems have been developed for radio contacts to be confirmed electronically. That is, instead of exchanging cell cards, a hard copy, a confirmation of a radio contact has to be sent using airmail. Both hams submit the log information to a central computer service that records the radio contact. The American Radio League offers the logbook of the world, LOTW, supports these awards, DXCC, WIS, BUCC, and CQWPX. The EQSL website was the first online QSL site, where they were offering electronic QSL card delivery and its own set of operating awards. Electronic confirmation of radio contacts is a huge improvement for ham radio, and it really the interest in DXing. While many of us are getting a paper copy QSL card, and I love them, collecting QSL for a while, it's difficult. Really, really difficult. Mailing QSL cards is becoming more and more expensive. Takes time, and often involves cross delays, while using the electronic ones is simply not fast and very, very fast. To wrap it up, the point of view is that the internet is not actually destroying amateur radio, but it is certainly changing the hobby a lot. The key is to keep having fun and enjoying the hobby. If you are having fun, you probably aren't doing it right. Now, my question to all the DXers Unlimited listeners around the world. What do you think about this today's topic? Send your opinions about today's DXers Unlimited special report titled Amateur Radio and the Shortwave and the impact, facing the impact of the internet. Send your email messages to info@rhc, I'll say it again, info@rhc@enet.cu, and via airmail to Arnicor or Radio Havana Cuba. Now at the very end of the program, the solar activity is full moon, solar flux around 7374 units, and propagation conditions are nothing to be thought to be good. They're just very good. very poor indeed.
And that's all for today. This is Arnie Cuoto, Radio Amateur CO2KK, your host here at Radio Havana's
DXers Unlimited,
saying 73 and
very good DX.
DXers Unlimited with Arnie Cuoto, heard every Tuesday here on Radio Havana Cuba. Also, we have DXers Unlimited on Sunday on RHC.